Welcome to Lingthusiasm, a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics. I'm Lauren Gawne.
And I'm Gretchen McCulloch. And today we're getting enthusiastic about the relationship of the translator and the text. But first, we're heading into Lingthusiasm Anniversary Month. This is our fourth anniversary of doing Lingthusiasm, and we're really excited that we're still doing this 4 years later.
We love a bit of reflection and nostalgia, and the month of November is always an opportunity to be grateful that we have another year of Lingthusiasm. We have a whole 12 great main episodes. We have 12 more bonus episodes. And as with every year, if you want to share a link to your favorite episode, November is an especially nice time to do it.
There are still people in this world who don't know that they could be listening to a fun podcast about linguistics that makes them feel like they're at a linguistics party instead of like doing the dishes. And you could help people find them. Most people still find podcasts through word of mouth. And every year when we've done this in November, we see a big spike in people listening to the show and finding the show. So if you want to share on social media, we are very happy to thank you if you tag us in things.
If you want to share off social media, please accept our deepest gratitude non-publicly for sharing shows as well.
Or if you share Lingthusiasm privately and you still want to be thanked, feel free to tell us about it on social media and we will still give you the little heart thank you comment. And yes, thank you already for all of the support that you've given the show over the years.
If you like things additional to podcasts, because we are coming up to the holiday season, it's also a good time to think about some Lingthusiasm merch or a copy of Because Internet. It's a pretty great book. I like it. It's available in paperback now. These things make great gifts.
We now also have annual memberships on Patreon, so that can make a great gift to gift somebody to listen to more Lingthusiasm episodes, as well as access to the Discord for an online linguistics community.
Our most recent bonus episode was about honorifics as a way of being polite to someone, either through the title you choose or a variety of linguistic strategies.
You can get access to the honorifics bonus as well as 43 other bonus episodes and new bonus episodes every month by going to patreon.com/lingthusiasm. So, Lauren, I need to talk to you about Beowulf.
I know this because you have been messaging me for weeks about how we have to talk about Beowulf.
So, there's a new translation of Beowulf. I'm really excited. And this made me want to build an entire episode around the sort of translator's relationship to the text. Because this new translation of Beowulf does a really cool job of it. And I want to talk about it.
I don't think you've been this excited about a translated text since Emily Wilson translated The Odyssey, and I'm pretty sure that's what motivated our 18th episode on word translation.
You are not wrong about this. And I think there's a similar sort of excitement that I have, which is old texts, you know, texts that are 1,000+ years old that have been translated so many different times by so many different people, it feels like it's hard for someone to do something new with the translation of them, and yet here people are doing that, which is exciting to me. So this is the new translation of Beowulf by Maria Dahvana Headley, and she's done some really cool things with translating Beowulf as a sort of feminist text and as a text that uses very modern style language in this like 1,000-year-old epic poem of Old English literature.
I feel like when it comes to translating, before you even translate one single word, there's like all these decisions that a translator has to make. You know, in episode 18, we looked at translation, but we looked at like word-to-word translation. And that's definitely one part of a translator's job, but they have so many more decisions to make. And it is such an impressive job. And it's why it's kind of, you know, as much an art form as it is a technical skill to translate something well. So what are some of the big decisions that Headley made before even starting to translate Beowulf?
One of the things about Beowulf is as an oral poem, it has this sort of intricate rhyme scheme. And the Old English rhyme scheme is based on half lines. You have each line has two halves, and there needs to be an alliterative bit in one half that is repeated in the second half.
So Old English is way more interested in alliteration compared to our modern English obsession with rhyming, and that's one of the stylistic features you find in Old English.
Right. It's all about the beginning of the words rather than the ends. And so trying to figure out, okay, how much am I going to use alliteration? How much am I going to try to represent? Because we can do alliteration in modern English. How much am I going to try to represent the existing rhyme scheme? Or am I going to try to put it in actual rhymes like you would do in modern English? If you're writing a poem, you might rhyme it. What am I going to do with the meter? And she's produced this really oral text that uses, like, uses a certain amount of modern slang as well in ways that are really effective. So one example is there's a dragon in Beowulf, and the dragon at one point is described as putting the world on blast.
Nice.
And to some extent, this is, you know, this is modern slang, but it's also a very literal thing that a dragon can do. And so it's not sort of using modern slang for gratuitous, like there's no lols or OMGs in this text. It's not sort of like, here's this facile, like text speak version of Beowulf. It's, what are the bits here that actually work with the meter and the rhyme scheme, but also not sort of shying away from using a modern idiom where a modern idiom really works?
It's interesting to put this in contrast to the other most famous version of Beowulf in translation that I know of, which is Seamus Heaney's from somewhere in the middle of the 20th century, where I feel like he tried to capture the kind of mythical grandeur of Old English and chose very kind of stoic, solid sounding Old English words. I don't think he would have had the dragon putting the world on blast.
Well, I don't think he would have. I think this is the 1999, I think it came out in 1999, this translation. And in some ways his translation is fairly vernacular, but he tries to do that in a different sense. Can I read you like the first bit of the Headley translation and the Heaney translation?
Yeah, this is super fun.
Okay, so a big thing about Beowulf translations is the first word, which in Old English is what? And that has gotten reproached as a meme, which we're not going to get into much detail about. And some people translate that as like lo or hark or listen or something like this. And Heaney translates that as so, which is already sort of got a certain level of vernacularity to it.
Hmm.
So his first three lines go, so the Spear Danes in days gone by and the kings who ruled them had courage and greatness. We have heard of those princes' heroic campaigns. So this is very sort of stately.
Yes.
And like, you know, here's this sort of thing you're going to do. And if you compare that with the first three lines of the Headley translation, the new one, where she translates this what as bro.
That's a very different tone.
And it's a very modern tone. I mean, you could pick a whole bunch of very modern things like yo or like hey y'all. But specifically, the reason she picks bro is because she wants to highlight the sort of bro culture-ness of this entire story. Mm-hmm. And you can see that in just the next couple lines, which is, bro, tell me we still know how to speak of kings. In the old days, everyone knew what men were. Brave, bold, glory-bound. Only stories now, but I'll sound the Spear Dane song, hoarded for hungry times. And he just leaps off the page in a way that really excites me.
Yeah, no princes there.
Right, kings who ruled them had courage and greatness, like the men were bold.
The thing I always love about Beowulf is that it's a millennium-old oral poem that happened to be written down. And a millennium ago, people were like, let me tell you about the olden days.
Right, it still takes place in this sort of semi-mythic space, and it uses a certain sort of stylized language that we even think was stylized at the time. So you're always picking between some kind of stylization. Like, there's no neutral choice that exists. All of the choices are recreations at some level.
I mean, it is kind of weird to think you're translating from English into English, but it just shows how much the language has moved on, because reading Beowulf, if you don't know Old English, is an incredibly uncomfortable attempt to just kind of guess some words that have retained some familiarity. So I always find it interesting that you have to translate, and then because English went through enough changes by Shakespeare, we kind of put up with all of the features of Shakespeare that aren't immediately obvious to us.
Right, but Beowulf is really this sort of alien text, like, what ye gardena, and gardena is Spear Danes, but, you know, we don't have Spear Danes, and gardena is not obviously related to those. There's this great mini-series from the History of English podcast that does a very in-depth, like, line-by-line reading of Beowulf, which I enjoyed a while back.
My one semantic anecdote from that series is Gar Danes as the Spear Danes. Garlic is the spear leak.
Yes, it is!
It's like a little spear.
It's like a little spear leak. I love that anecdote. And it's interesting to be reading Beowulf at the same time that my book club is actually reading The Tale of Genji.
Ah, from like a similar, like Genji's also a millennium old, yeah?
Yeah, so in some senses, like, Beowulf and Genji are kind of contemporaries.
But they're very much not contemporaries. Beowulf is about, like, warrior bro culture in the old English setting, whereas Genji is a Japanese court drama.
Yeah, like, I don't think they would have gotten along. I think they would have just found each other completely incomprehensible. And Genji's also one of those classic texts that's been translated a whole bunch of different times in a whole bunch of different ways. And for one thing, you're translating from a much older version of Japanese, and there are modern Japanese translations of The Tale of Genji as well. And then you're also translating into a different cultural context. But the cultural context for Beowulf is also, like, very weird. Like, I don't do going and fighting monsters under lakes any more than I do writing haikus about the moon. In fact, I'm probably more likely to write a haiku about the moon than I am to go fight a monster under a lake, if we want to talk about relatability.
Everything I know about Genji is because one of my colleagues in the languages department at La Trobe is a Genji studies scholar.
Mm.
So it's one of those pieces of work that is so big and so canonical that it has its own kind of literary studies tradition associated with it. I also really love my colleague because the other part of her expertise is cosplay studies. And I think it's such a, like, great combination of Japanese cultural experience there, Genji and cosplay.
I mean, what more do you want? The neat thing about reading Tale of Genji at the moment is because I'm reading it as part of a book club through Argo Bookshop, which is a bookstore that did the book launch party for Because Internet, and I really like them. And they're having this Tale of Genji book club, and we've been reading it throughout the year, mm-hmm. you know, a few chapters at a time, because it's like over 1,000 pages. It's huge. So we've been reading it section by section, and different members of the book club have picked different translations into English of the same work.
Ah, cool. Is there, like, radical differences between the translations, or do they all kind of try and go for a literal approach?
They're really different. One of the big things with Genji is, at the time, in 11th century Japan, it was considered very rude in the court to refer to people by their actual names.
Right.
So none of the characters in the original Tale of Genji manuscript have names, except for maybe Genji.
Wow.
So you can imagine reading, like, a 1,000-page book where none of the characters have names is a bit of a feat of the imagination.
Yes.
And so different translations, and a lot of them have sort of conventional names that literary scholars have used to talk about the characters.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, Lady Fujitsubo lives in the Fujitsubo, which is the Western Pavilion, and so she gets called in the tradition Fujitsubo because that's where she lives, and this kind of stuff. Or Murasaki gets called that after a flower, I think, the character. And so in some translations, they just use these conventional use names as if they're the actual names of the characters. And in some translations, they just use descriptions like the original text did, and they don't really refer to characters by even pretend names or use names.
Right. So one of them is trying to strive for cultural authenticity, and the other one is trying to just help the poor, confused reader a little bit more. And that's choices that each translator has decided to make.
Right, exactly. And you also have other types of decisions, like, are you going to try to, because it's a court drama, you have all these sort of court positions. And are you going to try to map those positions onto, like, a Western court so that people understand, like, what a chancellor is?
Mm-hmm.
Or are you going to try to use those as a more direct translation of what the specific terms were at the time? And that's just, like, different decisions that different translations can use.
And when you meet as a book club, is everyone kind of following along, or is there a lot of, like, clarifying across the translations? It's such an interesting little exercise.
Yeah, well, the nice thing is the division into different chapters is very constant. So we can be like, hey, we're reading chapters like 6 to 10
mm-hmm.
now, and we're going to talk about what happens in those. But sometimes you do sort of pull something up and you're like, okay, so this bit where this thing was said, do we think Genji is kind of misogynistic here? And somebody will say, well, in my translation, it doesn't actually seem like he's misogynistic. And, you know, here's what's kind of going on, you know, in this particular translation versus that particular translation, and how much of it is the translator bringing their own preconceived notions of how people relate to each other, because some of these translations are from the 1920s or something. People may have had a bit of different politics there. And how much of that is in the original text, which was composed by a woman who we don't know that much about, but it's the first modern novel. So, yeah, it's an interesting sort of, like, how much are you going to try to westernize this book for a Western audience, which some of the older translations do a bit more with the sort of westernization adaptation, because people in the West hadn't heard of Genji very much before, and so you kind of do all this adaptation for your English-speaking readers. Whereas more recent translators, people tend to have a higher degree of expectations of fidelity when it comes to a more modern translation, and so sometimes they try to do that. And, you know, how many footnotes do you have, and how much do you try to explain additionally, and how much do you try to just make the text stand on its own as a story?
So many choices to make as a translator. I'm eternally grateful to people who do this and make it appear so effortless while doing so much work, bringing all of this context together.
Yeah, it's really neat. And, you know, I'm not going to read this 1,000-page book like 5 different times in 5 different translations, but being able to experience portions of those translations vicariously through other people talking about, oh, here's what happened in this one, here's what happened in this one, it does let you do this sort of interesting comparative textual study.
I've been thinking about translation in practice a lot lately because, having worked with PM Freestone on their Shadow Scent books, The Darkest Bloom and The Crown of Smoke, these books have gone into translation in a whole bunch of languages, mostly European languages to date, Spanish, German, French, Russian, and Polish. And I'm very excited about the upcoming Hungarian translation, which will be the first outside of the Indo-European language. But these translations involve kind of a couple of things that are really interesting in that in these books, I worked on creating the Aram Tescan language. And for this language to work across different languages, sometimes it gets technically transliterated, or you need to add a different type of plural. So, like, for example, Russian has a different alphabet to English. Mm-hmm. And so you need to fit this language into the Russian Cyrillic alphabet.
So you're not trying to pretend that, like, Aram Tescan is always written with the Latin alphabet, even when the book itself is in Russian. You're like, we're going to transliterate it into Cyrillic.
No, the translators have just very much done what they think is most appropriate. And it's really, I have a habit of buying these translations now and checking out what they've done, because they're not just translating from English into another language. They also have to translate this completely fictional language and this fictional world into that language as well. So, you know, it's one thing to maybe study in depth old English warrior culture or Japanese court culture and decide what to bring across, but with a kind of fantasy world, there's all kinds of choices you have to make as a translator as well.
Yeah, like, what are you going to do with, like, the magic system? Or if you've invented all of these words for different scents or something, then they have to figure out some sort of equivalent of inventing those words for the other language.
Yeah, there's a lot of scent vocabulary, even in the English, that PM Freestone has written in, so really taxing that part of the translator's repertoire. But one thing that's been particularly interesting, and that there's been some kind of discussion on how to manage, is that in this world, both in the historical part of the world and the contemporary part of the world, the culture and the grammar allow for gender-neutral third person, like the English modern use of they, which Kirby Conrad gave a great interview about how that works in contemporary English. In fact, I did a little historical evolution of the pronoun system that fits with the story of the world, where originally there was no gender distinction in the pronoun system, which fits with the old religious system of the world, and then the religious system evolved younger gods that are all gendered, and the pronoun system evolved genders at the same time, while still having that scope for gender neutral. And without spoiling too much, but a character that pops up in book one and is much more a part of book two is gender fluid within the world. And that works for current English because we have gender neutral singular they, but there are some languages like Czech or like Russian that the book's being translated into where there isn't that flexibility in the linguistic system, and so decisions have to be made about how that is negotiated in the translation.
Do you know what they did?
I don't know what they did for Russian yet, but I believe the solution in Czech is at various times this character is overtly identified using masculine and at other times using feminine.
Oh yeah, okay.
And so being much more flexible about the duality of their relationship with gender.
This reminds me of a thing that I heard Ada Palmer talk about at a conference panel with her books To Like the Lightning and the sequels, which are set in this, you know, far future of English well, far future, and they're written in English, in which singular they is used for everybody, except when you're writing in this sort of, you know, faux archaic style with thous and these and he's and she's, and it's very marked at that point. And Ada Palmer was talking about how this was translated into French, where in modern English, the progressive thing that people do is like, oh, you can use singular they, that's very progressive. In modern French, the progressive thing that people do is they make feminine versions of all of the professions.
Right.
So you have, you know, feminine versions of professor or doctor or these kinds of things to try to make the gender more visible. And so to erase the gender in the French version wouldn't have the same sort of effect, where you'd end up like using the default masculine or something in the French version. It wouldn't have the same sort of effect as using singular they all the time in the English version. And it also, there are modern French pronouns like il that have been coined to solve this problem of using a gender-neutral third-person pronoun, but it wouldn't work to use them in this particular case because the style is supposed to be faux archaic.
Mm.
And so what the translator ended up doing was digging out this French pronoun en, which in the modern form, en is used like we or like one does this. It's kind of really, it's related to like one does this.
Yeah.
There's an older usage of en, which is like a sort of non-specific third-person pronoun as well that many people, I didn't know about it. I speak French, but I didn't know about this archaic form. And the translator kind of went and looked for like what other historic pronoun things could I do and ended up with doing this en thing, which is a really interesting kind of adaptation.
And the thing I find interesting is if you were like 50 years ago, you didn't have the grammatical resources in English to use singular they for a specific person, something that's really only emerged in the last couple of decades. And so, you know, I think the translator has felt frustrated to not have, you know, you sometimes feel like you've got this roadblock because you don't have resources in one language that you have in another, and you have to innovate. I did have a colleague in Italian studies tell me that they read a whole novel once where the gender of one of the characters was deliberately written around and avoided in a way that was an incredibly artful, thoughtful translation. And so it is possible that you could maybe do this with this character in the Shadow Sent books, but it would be such...
But you couldn't do it with the whole world in the Terry Gnota books, because all of the characters would have to have that.
Yeah, and you could do that amount of heavy lifting at the cost of some other things, but when you're doing, you know, a efficient translation for a commercial novel, you don't have the resources to really max out your art and strategy in that way. And it's kind of interesting that, you know, translation is a really resource-intensive activity, even to just do a good translation, let alone an incredibly strategic and thoughtful translation.
Yeah, and it involves even, you know, translating one word, like that word at the beginning of Beowulf, involves thinking about, okay, what kind of relationship do I want this word to have to the rest of the text? And what am I trying to set up here in relationship to the whole text? Where do I see this attention-getting word as going? Like, what the text as a whole is doing? Which is sort of this interesting question. I should say, speaking of translation news, this is very hot off the presses, but I have received news that there are going to be translations of Because Internet into Persian, Chinese, and Japanese. So Persian is an Indo-European language, but it has a different writing system, and then two non-Indo-European languages, and I don't know anything else about the details yet.
This is news that I didn't even know. This is very exciting.
It's very recent, yes. So it's not, I don't know, I will have official links when they exist. They won't exist for, I don't know, probably a couple of years. I don't know how long it'll take them to do. I know nothing.
The surreal thing about translation means that you will see your work and not be able to read it.
Yeah.
And there's something so amazing and magical about that, that, you know, words you have created are finding new audiences. You know, there's a lot of trust in the translator in those contexts.
Yeah, and I don't know if I'm going to get to have any say in like who they get to translate it and how much they know about the internet or things like that.
And translating nonfiction is an entirely different process because you're not translating an internal narrative world as much as you are potentially translating something that explains how this world that we live in right now exists or how a set of historical realities existed. But that also takes deftness and skill.
And you're potentially trying to translate, like, technical vocabulary between one language or another, which isn't necessarily the same as, like, okay, we need to keep the characters' names consistent. It's like, we need to use this word that has a technical meaning in its technical sense. And speaking of nonfiction translation, I don't know if you've been following in, you know, translation news relatively recently. There's been a lot of things going on with the Scots language Wikipedia.
Yes, I did read about this. So Scots language is a language in the same family as English. It has a lot of similarities with English, but is considered its own variety, using that very deliberate linguist term where you don't commit to just how much it's a dialect or its mutual intelligibility with other varieties that it's related to. And it has its own Wikipedia.
And Scots is kind of like, you know, as an English speaker, I've always been kind of jealous of people who speak like Dutch or German or something, because they can kind of understand each other a bit, or, you know, Spanish and Portuguese and Italian, because they can, you know, kind of approximate understanding each other to some extent, even if they haven't formally learned languages. And I've always been like, why doesn't English have some closer neighbors? But I hadn't been thinking about Scots when I was thinking that. So Scots is probably English's closest neighbor, but is still a distinct language. And especially there are, you know, grammatical differences, and there are a lot of political reasons as well why people consider it its own language. However, the Scots language Wikipedia, which has all of these articles written in Scots, had apparently been being edited for the last, like, 7 years by an American teenager who didn't know any Scots and was just looking up the English articles in a Scots English dictionary word by word and just picking the first word of the translation and subbing that in for the Scots word.
This has been such a difficult story to read because everyone throughout this process has acted in the best faith, and this teenager wasn't doing this for any reason other than a passion for sharing knowledge on Wikipedia and a passion for seeing the Scots Wikipedia grow, but with a really uncritical approach to translation. And you can see where translation really does require this understanding of vocabulary choice and style choice, and how it can all go really, really wrong.
Yeah, it's really painful because, like, this person started when they were, like, 12. And we have all believed very foolish things about the world when we were 12. It just, many of us didn't write, like, thousands of Wikipedia articles in a language that is just really not the way anybody who actually speaks this language actually writes, because it's kind of cobbled together badly from a dictionary. Like, it's this very painful, like, oh no, you thought you were helping, and yet Wikipedia is used as the basis of a lot of machine translation and language detection, you know, various natural language processing tools. And so this has been potentially sort of sabotaging the efforts to try to create other machine tools in Scots, because they've all been in this, like, weird dictionaryified version of English.
It's been really heartening to see the Scots language community and the Scottish Wikipedia community come together to kind of figure out a strategy for how to approach cleaning house. I guess it's like the biggest spring clean ever, right? Like, how to approach this, like, thousands and thousands of articles with this very strange approach to translation.
And it kind of illuminates one of the issues with smaller language Wikipedias in general, which is that they may only have a few active editors, because to be a Wikipedia editor is to be a volunteer, and it takes a long time to translate things or to write articles. And if you're a language like English, you can have tens of thousands of editors. But if you're a language like Scots, which has many fewer speakers, you may only have like a dozen active editors, of which maybe one of them is a well-meaning but very clueless American teenager.
We've both done lots of Wikipedia editing. We have run LingWiki events to improve linguistics content on Wikipedia, and it's challenging enough to write these articles in one language that I'm proficient in. I'm always in awe of people who choose to translate and support content in their second or third languages, because it is a non-trivial task to translate really complicated information in a way that is really clear.
Yeah, and it's translation is a technical task that is one of those things that kind of looks at all of the different levels of language, where you have some things at the, you know, individual word or even sound, or like if you're trying to translate poetry and you want to make it sort of beautiful in a very aesthetic sense with the sort of physical properties of language, all the way up to words and sentences and structure and sort of these discoursey particles like what at the beginning, where you're trying to picture a whole framing device for the structure of an entire tone of a narrative. Or if you're trying to pick, like, okay, how are we going to treat technical vocabulary that maybe has been borrowed from English because it's, you know, scientific vocabulary was invented from English. How are you going to treat that when it gets borrowed into Scots? And trying to figure out how to make these technical decisions is non-trivial. And it's this very interesting sort of train wreck. You know, it can go spectacularly right when you have this sort of very clever decision for a dragon to put the world on blast. And it can also go spectacularly wrong when you just say, okay, I'm going to look through a dictionary and pick the first word I encounter.
One of the great things about appreciating a good translation is that language never takes a break and culture continues to change and we move further away from the era of Beowulf. We move into new cultural settings and new cultural expectations. And so it means that there is space for new translations that bring new approaches or try something different or aim for really capturing something about the language of the era that it was created in or set an old story in a radically new setting. And even when you find a really satisfying translation, you know there's still possibilities for finding other interesting ways to engage with the text.
I think that's the thing that's exciting about both these sort of translations of these thousand-year-old texts, so they're Beowulf or Tale of Genji, where they go through, you know, lots of different authors who put their own spin on the translation. And also thinking of Wikipedia as a place for translation where you have multiple authors working together on the same shared text. And, you know, a bunch of different people, like Scots Wikipedia has been having these Wikipedia edit-a-thons to try to clean the place up. And you have a whole bunch of contributors that are finding out about this need because of this story and coming in and working on the text together and contributing to the shared text. And in many ways, even though each of these editions of the translations are published as their own book for the book-length ones, they're still... It's this very intimate relationship that you can have with a text when you're trying to render it in a different language or in a different textual interpretation. For more Lingthusiasm and links to all the things mentioned in this episode, go to lingthusiasm.com. You can listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, YouTube, or wherever else you get your podcasts. And you can follow at Lingthusiasm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr. You can get IPA scarves, IPA ties, and other Lingthusiasm merch at lingthusiasm.com/merch. I can be found as @GretchenAMcSee on Twitter, my blog is allthingslinguistic.com, and my book about internet language is called Because Internet.
I tweet and blog as Superlinguo. Have you listened to all the Lingthusiasm episodes and you wish there were more? You can get access to 44 bonus episodes right now to listen to at patreon.com/lingthusiasm or follow the links from our website. Patrons also get access to our Discord chat room to talk with other linguistics fans and other rewards, as well as helping to keep the show ad-free. Recent bonus topics include pangrams, honorifics, and linguistics with kids. If you can't afford to pledge, that's okay too. We really appreciate it if you can recommend Lingthusiasm to anyone who needs a little more linguistics in their life, especially as it's the anniversary month.
Lingthusiasm is created and produced by Gretchen McCulloch and Lauren Gawne. Our senior producer is Claire Gawne, our editorial producer is Sarah Dopirala, and our music is Ancient City by The Triangles.
Stay Lingthusiastic!